All right, good morning and welcome to today's media availability with the Tennessee football defensive staff. Here's our format for today. We'll bring Coach Heupel up, who will make some remarks, and then we'll take a few questions for Coach Heupel. We will then get started with each of our assistants. The order will be as follows: defensive coordinator Tim Banks, followed by defensive line coach Rodney Garner. We'll then go to special teams coordinator and outside linebackers coach Mike Ekeler, and follow that with linebackers coach Brian Jean-Marie. And then we'll close with secondary coach Willie Martinez. A reminder, please keep your screen muted until you're called on. Please hit the raise your hand function and we'll call on you. And we ask that you please state your name and affiliation so all the coaches could get familiar with you. I will now turn it over to Tennessee head coach Josh Heupel.
Morning, everybody. Hope everybody's doing great. I want to start by just saying congratulations to Coach Barnes and the basketball team yesterday. Great come-from-behind victory, and wish them well as they get ready for tournament play this week here. Excited to be able to introduce our defensive staff, a group of men that really excited about. They've hit the ground running here this past week and a half with our players and already getting some things implemented and getting ourselves prepared for spring ball. Excited about a group of men, who they are, how they're going to impact our players in a positive way off the field. A group of high-energy men that have a ton of experience. I think 4 out of the 5 have coordinator experience. 4 out of the 5 have SEC ties and have been inside of this league before. A group of elite recruiters that can help us recruit the biggest and the best here to Knoxville, Tennessee. Coach Banks, it was important to me on the defense side of the ball that I got somebody that had a clear vision and had some experience in what they were doing on the defense side of the football. I believe that our philosophies pair together extremely well. Guy that's had a coordinator title here the last 14 years of his coaching career, I believe. Look at the last 5 years, what he's been a part of at Penn State. You just look at their ability to create zero negative plays. I think they're top 5 or top 10 in pretty much every one of those categories here over the last 5 years. It's going to give us the ability to be multiple in what we do, be aggressive in nature, tremendous teacher, and I think we'll be a perfect fit for what we're doing here in Knoxville, Tennessee. Done a great job of developing guys at all 3 levels as a coordinator, talking about D-line linebackers and the secondary position. Will work with us primarily on the special on the back end with our secondary there, but really excited about him. Our outside linebackers coach and special teams coordinator, Mike Ekeler, a guy that I've known dating back to our time together at Oklahoma. You just look at his track record of where he's been, the success that they've had. Another guy that has coordinator experience on the defense coordinator position, but also has done it on the special team side here, coming from North Texas. But has been inside of this league, handled special teams at Georgia when he was there with Coach Richt as well, and brings a tremendous amount of knowledge to the special team side of it here inside of our program. Another guy that's got tremendous amount of energy, elite recruiter, excited about having him and his family here. Linebackers coach, Brian Jean-Marie, just excited about who he is, having competed against him, and schematically what he did, the problems that he caused as a coordinator. We'll coach our linebackers coming from Michigan, known as an elite recruiter everywhere that he's been. Great developer of guys at that second level and at the linebacker position. You look at the amount of guys that he's been able to recruit and then develop and have an opportunity to go play in the NFL. A perfect fit for us at that position. Rodney Garner, our defensive line coach, guy that's coached 30-plus years inside the SEC. This is his second go-around here in Tennessee. I think he's got over 10 first-round draft picks at the D-line position. Known and is a great recruiter just because of he's genuine. He is who he is. He does a great job of developing relationships. I've seen that in the short amount of time that he's been here. His ability to impact our players in a positive way, clear set of standards and expectations, and getting those guys to really buy in. Elite as far as being a teacher at D-line play. His ability to teach those guys an overall scheme, but really the fundamentals and technique at that position going to allow us to recruit the best. And the last guy that I want to talk about is Coach Willie Martinez. We've been together at our previous stop at Oklahoma, where I got to know him and his family in the last 3 years at UCF. Been inside of this league for over 15 years, both as a position coach and a long tenure as a coordinator as well. Brings a tremendous amount of wealth of knowledge, great recruiter, great human being, great family, and is going to provide a lot of insight on that side of it. Great teacher of the game, and you just look at who he is and what he's produced everywhere that he's been. NFL players at every stop, is known as one of the elite coaches in the secondary position. A group of guys that collectively have experience, have a wealth of knowledge, invest in their players, and are going to be great recruiters for us, and excited about having these guys here on the defensive side of the football. With that, I'll open it up to a few questions here.
All right, we'll take a few questions, and then so we stay on schedule here, we'll start with David Pascal.
Josh, how important was SEC experience, especially when you've got folks that have worked together? I know Rodney and Willie worked together under Mark Rickstaff for almost a decade together, and Ekeler worked later under Rick. Just how you kept mentioning SEC experience. How important was that in your search?
Yeah, it was a big part of you know, for us as a staff and as you assemble your 10 assistants and just collectively the balance that you want to have, having some ties inside of this conference, knowing how it operates, knowing the landscape of it was important for me. I think you hit on something that was important as well. When you're bringing together a group of guys, some familiarity with who they are individually and some connections there, make the transition into that meeting room, the trust factor. Is really important, and I think we accomplished that as well. I think our players see how in sync those guys are and just how they operate and communicate and as they put in their scheme as well. So you put all those factors together, I think that's a big part of it. And then, you know, their SEC experience is important too, just in that they have some ties in the recruiting world here to our footprint as well.
Go to Brent Hubbs, then Jimmy Hines.
Coach, when you look at the last month, 6 weeks, whatever it's been now, where are you in terms of getting your priorities done in terms of your checklist? How do you feel like this team is and this program is getting ready to go into spring practice? Where do you think you guys are with all of that?
Right, well, I feel like we're in a good spot heading into spring ball. We basically have 2 weeks left. With some of the recruiting landscape as far as pushing back, you know, our ability to be on the road recruiting. We pushed back the start of spring ball 1 week, giving our guys, in particular the defense side of the football, another week to get their feet on the ground. These guys, you know, we're announcing them today. They've been here for a week and really probably closer to 2 weeks that staff's been here with us. I think we're in a really good spot. You look at what they've done inside of our strength and conditioning program, I think we'll be prepared, having made some gains, but be prepared to go compete during the course of spring ball as well. So I like where we're at.
Josh, you've got a lot of defensive assistants that have not worked together, and I wonder the scheme that Banks brings in. Will it be his scheme, or will it be a combination with input from the defensive assistants?
It'll be a combination of some things that Coach Banks has done throughout his tenure, not just what he's done at Penn State. I think for us and where our roster is at, I think it's important that you have the ability to be flexible and to put your kids in a position of success. And I think you have to be multiple in today's game. I think that's a part of creating zero and negative plays, getting offenses off schedule. And that's, you know, both in your front and then what you're seeing on the back end as well.
And do you try to suit your scheme to the personnel that you have?
For sure. I think you got to do that in all three phases. I think it's important that you find personnel that you know, can fit into your overall strategy of what you want to do, but you got to take a look at what your personnel can do at a really high level and then put them in a position of being successful.
We'll go to Mike Wilson and Wes Rock.
Yeah, Josh, obviously when you were hired, Kevin Steele had just been hired on to staff here. Was there ever a consideration of keeping him as an assistant coach, and why was the decision ultimately made to not?
Yeah, Kevin's a great coach. He's been inside of this league for a long time and obviously has some ties to Tennessee as well. I wish him nothing but the best as he moves on in his coaching career in the future. Ultimately felt like this is the right collection of talent here to lead our players and help lead this football program.
Josh, how would you describe the level of buy-in that you're getting from the players that are still here? I know, obviously, that some guys have left, but the ones who are still here, what kind of buy-in are you getting from them?
Yeah, at the end of the day, it's always about the players that you have. I don't care if that's, you know, players that transition out of your program or who you don't get in recruiting. It's always about who is here. The level of buy-in has been phenomenal from our players. The accountability factor, those guys wanted it. They've bought into it. They're trusting the process of getting ourselves prepared to go compete during spring ball. We call this our first quarter of the off season here, strength and conditioning side of it, and starting to get some installs as far as what we're doing in all three phases of the game as well. But the guys have been great, great energy, great buy-in, excited about what we're doing. Great chemistry, I think, in the locker room as well. And those are all things that we're going to have to continue to develop here as we move through this off season process.
Austin Price and Blake Topmeyer.
Coach, will you wait until after you kind of go through spring and see where you are from a roster standpoint to see where you all may target in the transfer portal after spring? Or do you already kind of have a feel for, you know, what position you're going to need help at?
Our coaching staff has come in here. You watch cut-ups of each individual player, trying to give yourself a baseline of who they are, what their skill set is, you know, potentially some subtle tweaks to what position they might be playing in or positions that you're going to put them in. But I think you find out a whole lot more. I think it's important inside of your program every day to not judge them for who they were. That's, you know, on the field or off the field, judging for who they are today. You got to give these players an opportunity to grow inside of your strength and conditioning program, you know, get some installs, get their feet on the grass, and have an opportunity to work and coach with them. And you'll find a whole lot more out as you go through spring ball.
Josh, you mentioned that Tim Banks's philosophy aligns with yours. Can you elaborate on that a little bit and describe it? In what ways Tim's philosophy, what he wants to do on defense, aligns with you?
Yeah, I think it's really important. You know, in my introductory press conference, it was important to me. Like, we want to be aggressive in nature in who we are and how we play the football game. You got to let your players cut it loose and go play on game day. But that's also philosophically, you know, how you're going to align and put your kids in a position of success. I think it's important that we are multiple on that side of the football. I think that's a part of causing issues for who you're facing on the offensive side of the football. You have to be a great teacher of that. If you're going to be multiple, you got to be a great teacher and be able to teach it in a way where there's a lot of things going on, but your kids have some rules that give them something to grab onto so that they can adjust quickly. And I think you just look at his track record, being aggressive, creating zero negative plays, being multiple. Those are all things that were important to me in hiring a defense coordinator.
All right, thank you, Coach. We want to stay on schedule here. We have Coach Banks coming up next.
Guys, appreciate it. Have a great day.
little Coke.
Now welcome Tennessee defensive coordinator Tim Banks. Ask a question to Coach Banks. Please hit the raise your hand function. And a reminder, please state your name and affiliation so Coach can get familiar with you. We'll start with Ben McKee.
Coach, Ben McKee with Rocky Top Insider. Coach Heupel talked about you also going to be working with the defensive backs. I'm curious as to which aspects of the defensive backs you'll be working with, whether that's the safeties or the corners, and do you have a preference which ones you'll kind of be working with extensively?
Yeah. Hey, Ben, how you doing, brother? Appreciate the question. No, you know, to be honest, I'll be working with both. You know, I've coached the back end for a long time, you know, obviously played the position. You know, so obviously having Willie Martinez with us, you know, gives me a lot of flexibility. You know, if I'm training the corners, you know, I feel very comfortable that he can train the safeties and, you know, we'll be on the same page. But, you know, anytime you're dealing with the back end, you want to make sure those guys understand and basically hear one message. You know, we can't have anything lost in translation. So, you know, as much as we both can coach the back end and not necessarily the safeties and the corners, but coaching the DBs, I think it just makes it that much smoother in terms of everything that we want to get done.
Go to Patrick Brown and David Pascal.
Hey, Tim. Patrick Brown with 24/7 Sports. I'm curious, what does the process look like for you in terms of getting to know your personnel before you start spring, and how much do you maybe reserve judgment for you, yourself, and your staff of what you want to see, what these guys can do when they're on the field once you guys get to spring ball here in a couple weeks?
Hey, Patrick. That's definitely a great question. I think anytime you're trying to build something, you got to know what parts you have, right? You know, so right now, you know, we're evaluating, you know, everything that these guys obviously did last season. You know, we've been fortunate enough to be able to, you know, get around these guys and see them work a little bit in the weight room and, you know, some different movement activities on the field. You know, so at that point, we're just evaluating, you know, trying to figure out, you know, what they do, how they move. And obviously, we'll center the package around it. But right now, that's what we're doing. You know, we're just gathering as much information as we can to make sure when it's time for the lights to come on that we can put these guys in the best possible position to be successful.
Hey, Tim. David Pascal down here at the Chattanooga Times Free Press. I know when Josh was hiring the offensive side, there was a lot of familiarity with all the folks he was bringing up from UCF. A little bit different from you on the defensive side, but you do have Willie and Rodney that coached together in Georgia for a long time. I know Mike also coached in Georgia later, but have you already noticed that familiarity with Willie and Rodney having worked together, and does that help having coaches that have been together like that?
Yeah, I think anytime you get guys that have a relationship, I think it helps, you know, and obviously Willie and Coach Gardner having a chance to work together, you know, for a number of years at a different place, I think obviously helps. But at the end of the day, you know, we're building this thing together. You know, I've known Willie, you know, for 20 plus years, you know, going back to my days as a player. And, you know, I've known Rodney probably not quite as long, you know, but obviously, you know, going out and recruiting the South like I did and having a chance to bump into him and, you know, and having some mutual friends, you know, we've really hit the ground running. And, you know, we're definitely building a bond that obviously will bode well for us when it's time to get going.
Blake Topmeyer, then Jimmy
Himes. Hey, Tim, Blake Topmeyer, the Knoxville News Sentinel. I was wondering, what's your assessment of the level of talent that you step into here with this defense? And then also, you know, I know you want to be multiple schematically, but do you see yourself more as a four-man front type of defense?
Yeah, you know, again, I think we're still in the, you know, getting to know each other phase. Yeah, Blake, if that makes sense. So, you know, we watched the tape. You know, obviously there's some talented young men out there, or else they wouldn't be at a place like Tennessee. You know, but to what degree and what they can do moving forward, you know, we got to continue to evaluate it. But I feel good. You know, I feel like we'll have a chance to look these guys in the eye and have a strong plan that gets them in the best position to be successful. You know, as far as the 4-3 or 3-4 and, you know, all those type of things, you know, once again, you know, what do we have to work with? You know, again, as we continue to go through spring, you know, we evaluate it, you know, we'll make some decisions moving forward that obviously, you know, puts the players in the best light, which in turn puts our defense in the best light. But right now, you know, we're trying to continue to evaluate the talent level and see what these guys can obviously do and do well.
Coach Jimmy Hines with the Sports Animal in Knoxville. How much of your scheme do you hope to install in the spring?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think just the base, you know, we're always going to put the base in first, you know, and start from the ground up working this thing. You know, as we start to get, you know, more exotic, you know, based on, you know, the appetite that the kids have to be able to digest, you know, some of the more, you know, strenuous mentally things that may be within the package, you know, we'll be able to look at that toward the end of spring would be my guess. But naturally, you want to start from A to B first and work your way to Z. So we want to get the base foundation in, see what these kids can do, see what kind of appetite they have, you know, and then we'll move forward in terms of, you know, putting them in some more what we would deem as exotics.
And also, how difficult is it now to play defense with all these complex offenses, the RPO, the variety of things that you see from week to week?
It's challenging. You know, but I think that's the thing that makes you excited about having an opportunity to play defense. You know, it's a lot of things that, you know, you're going to see week in and week out, you know, but the variations from week in and week out is there as well. So I think that's why you need to be multiple. You know, you play on a team that maybe is more of a power team versus a team that's more spread versus a team that's more tempo. You know, you have to put a system in place that gives these kids a chance to make adjustments obviously during the game, but for us as coaches week to week. So, you know, that's the challenge, you know, and it's not for everyone, but for us, we're excited about the opportunity and we're looking forward to, you know, competing and going against some of these high powered offenses.
Gustavo, then Brent Hubbs.
Gustavo Tomazelli, WHK 90.3, The Rock here in UTG campus. First of all, welcome. Tin, so what are your first impressions of the University of Tennessee, you know, being here, the environment, you know, the players? What are your first impressions being here in UG?
It's just a great place, you know. Obviously, it's to me, the thing that I'm really enjoying so far, you know, it still has that small college town feel, you know, but it has some city amenities. You know, I think we'll be able to attract, you know, some of the best student athletes, you know, around the country because, you know, whether we're recruiting in a small town or if you're going to get a city kid, I don't think it'll matter. I think because Knoxville has a little bit for everyone, you know, and obviously when you start to combine it with, you know, playing in a conference like the SEC and having a chance to, you know, get a great education here, you know, I just feel like we have a product that, you know, we'll be able to sell and sell around the country. So it's been awesome, but I'm really enjoying the town feel, but obviously the city amenities is something that I think will bode well, you know, for the future for all the young men that we're looking for.
Coach Banks, Brent Hubbs with VolQuest.com. Two things. One, what's the first couple of weeks been like and just trying to get your feet on the ground and get a defense sort of together? And two, what's been the buy-in, in your opinion, on your guys' part, on your players' part for that side of the ball?
Yeah, it's been a whirlwind, to be quite honest with you, but in a good way. You know, it's obviously a lot of moving parts at play, you know, finishing up the defensive staff and making sure we're getting the right people in here, which we did, you know, and then obviously getting to know your players. And you know, we understand, you know, we talk to our guys about love, trust, and urgency. You know, and obviously the love is unconditional. You know, we love these guys. The minute I signed the contract, I fell in love, you know, but obviously the trust part, you know, is typically earned over time, you know, so just kind of getting to know these guys and they're getting to know me and figuring out, you know, for me how to motivate them. And, you know, those guys understand very clearly what my expectations are. You know, that takes time, you know, but I feel like we got a good room. I think we got a good bunch of guys that are hungry to reach their full potential. And, you know, but I understand it's a work in progress, but the trust piece is always big no matter where you go, and that's what we're kind of working through right now. But I'm excited, and I think the group is excited as well.
Last two questions, Wes Rupford and Mike Wilson.
Yeah, I'm wondering, just to back up a little bit here, this is Wes Rupford with 24/7 Sports, but backing up a little bit, when you took this job, what made this the job take at the time for you? I know that for all the upside this program has and the tradition it has, it's not been a great, you know, decade, 12 years or whatever it's been. What made this the right move for you right now?
Well, I think just like with any organization, it always starts at the top with Coach Hype. You know, obviously the success he's had at UCF and, you know, obviously as an offensive coordinator, I think speaks for itself, you know, and having a chance to, you know, talk to some of my guys that had a relationship with him, and everything that I heard about him being a great man, you know, obviously a great coach, but just a great man, was something that intrigued me. And then I think you said it already, when you start to talk about, you know, Tennessee and the success they've had, you know, a lot of programs are talking about what they want to do, and the reality of it is Tennessee has done it. You know, obviously, you know, we know there's some work to be done to get back to where we want to go, but at the end of the day, you know, having a chance to work with great people and having a chance to do it together was just an opportunity that I didn't feel like I could pass up on.
Last question, Mike.
Yeah, Tim, Mike Wilson from the Knoxville News Sentinel. I have two parts to the question. One, do you expect Henry Toto and Ramirez Crouch to play for your defense this year? And two, with your recruiting ties to Detroit, is that something you're going to try to work to get guys from, I mean, with the talent at King, Cass Tech, Belleville, places like that, to get some of those guys down to Knoxville as well?
Yeah, well, dealing with the first question, you know, we don't have a timeline on those guys. You know, they're not here, obviously, at this point. So, you know, we're super excited about the guys that are here in this program that are working. But, you know, we'll figure that out as we go. But right now, we're just concerned with the guys that are here. As it relates to, you know, the Detroit area or Michigan in general, I mean, we're going to recruit nationally. You know, we're obviously going to try to get the best possible student-athletes we can, you know, here at UT. But obviously having great ties, you know, to Michigan and the city of Detroit, you know, we look forward to recruiting any of those guys there that, you know, fit what we're looking for in terms of, you know, student-athlete. So, yeah, we'll definitely open up those pipelines and get this thing going as we will all over the country.
Thank you, Coach.
Okay. Thank you, guys. Really appreciate it. Go Vols.
Coach up, defensive line coach Rodney Garner. To ask a question to Coach Garner, please hit the raise your hand function and please state your name and affiliation. We'll start with David Pascal.
Hey, Rodney. David Pascal here at the Chattanooga Times Free Press. Hope you're doing well. Good to see you again. Wanted to know, it's been 25 years since you walked into Knoxville the first time. What's changed more, you or Knoxville?
I think we both changed. But it's good to be back on Rocky Top. It's exciting for me and my family. You know, it's something that, you know, we've talked about. Sort of like, you know, life's coming full circle, you know, being able to come back here. And obviously we were here in the late 90s and, you know, just the opportunity to be able to get, you know, Tennessee back to the elite status, you know, that, you know, we feel like it belongs to. And just trying to play whatever role or whatever, you know, what it is, you know, with, you know, being able to contribute to that.
Go to Jimmy Himes and Patrick Brown.
Rodney, Jimmy Himes with Sports Animal Radio in Knoxville. Talk a little bit about trying to teach veterans a new scheme. Do you think it's easier to teach guys that have been in the program a while a new scheme, or is it easier to teach incoming players in this game?
Well, you know, obviously, you know, as coaches, that's what we are. We're teachers. And I think, you know, young men, they're very adaptable. Obviously, you know, we're trying to take it at a pace and trying to help it correlate and relate to as much as possible, you know, what they knew before. And a lot of it, you know, schematically, maybe the same thing, it's just called something differently. And, you know, and obviously when we're trying to teach it, you know, I'm just trying to figure, okay, what did you guys call this last year when you did this particular movement or this particular stunt? So we can, you know, so this is same as, you know, a jab stunt, you know, same as a cowboy. You know, we may call it a ram or we may call it an egg, but it's the same as. And I think, you know, when you put it in those terms, you know, a lot of it, you know, it hits them like, okay, I got it, you know. But, you know, they're very resilient. I think the guys have adapted to the change pretty well. You know, obviously just the different personalities. They're trying to feel their way through. And I just think they're looking to see, you know, that you're going to be consistent in what you're doing. And that's the thing that, you know, we try to bring to the table every day.
Also, do you think it's harder now to play the defensive line considering all the variety of offenses that you face from week to week?
Well, obviously, you know, this league has changed. There's everybody now is evolving to the spread. So it's changed even, you know, schematically, you know, what type of body types that you're looking for. Because everybody's in the hurry up tempo, it's hard to sub guys in and out. So now you're really starting, as you're targeting your recruiting, you know, you're looking for guys that have that third down value, because you may not be able to get guys in and out, you know, after second down. So you got to be able to transition and play the third down. So, just trying to make sure that you're athletic enough up front to be able to do the things that need to be done, and also have the stoutness to be able to hold the point and not get displaced. So, you know, to me, it is a premium, you know, being a defensive lineman in this league.
Hey, Rodney, Patrick Brown with 24/7 Sports. Kind of following up on that, what was maybe some of your first impressions of the guys you're hearing? Obviously, you have a lot of guys that play a lot of football, a lot of veterans. What did you see when you watched film of them from last season, if you did? And maybe what did you think when you saw them and some of the workouts you guys have done since you've been here?
Well, you know, obviously we watch film to see guys play and see how they strike blocks, how stout they were and different things. But, you know, you're trying not to go into it with a preconceived idea. It's like I told them the other day when we were doing one of the workouts and just told them, you know, we're going to have to move guys around, put them in different positions to see how they fit schematically so we can try to put the best combination of guys out there on the field. I took them back to when I went back to the last place I was in 13. I probably had like 10 different starting lineups. You know, just trying to find the right matchups and getting guys playing with the right chemistry, so we could be successful, you know, defensively. So right now we're just trying to find out where guys fit the best and that they can execute and play at a championship level.
David Oven and Ben McKee.
Hey, Ronnie, David Oven with The Athletic. Kind of playing off that last question, how do you learn what guys can do? Is that solely a decision based on what you see in practice, or what's your research look like on it in the past? How do you learn?
Well, obviously, you know, it's obviously, you know, they're creatures of habit. Obviously what we do in practice, you know, what they put on tape, like I've tried to tell them, there's three things that will never lie to you. You know, that's the Bible, the mirror, and film. So, you know, obviously what they're putting on film, you know, that's who they are, what they are. But we've got to find a way to help them improve where they can execute at a high level. And the one thing that I think is very consistent, these guys are hungry. They want to win, and they want to play better, and they want to improve their game. So it's going to be exciting for both sides, for them and for me, to be able to work together and see what we can achieve.
Hey, Coach, Ben McKee of Rocky Top Insider. I'm curious as to when you are trying to figure out where guys fit best and when you're evaluating talent in high school, what are you looking for? What does a Rodney Garner defensive lineman look like?
Well, you know, obviously, you know, you start with measurables. You know, that's a given. Then, you know, we're looking for, you know, a skill set. You know, do they check the boxes, you know, as far as, you know, initial quickness, lateral movement, short area quickness, COD, what kind of ankle flexion, hip flexion, knee bend, you know, hip explosion, being able to create vertical power. Schematically, obviously, we're an attack and react front versus sitting on the line and reading. And then, it's hard. You know, you're looking at the character, the makeup of the young men, you know, what type of character they have. And then one of the things that's the hardest to gauge is what kind of competitiveness and what kind of heart they have, which, you know, which, you know, as you try to go through the recruiting process and get to know them and get to know their families and their makeup, you know, hopefully that'll be more revealing.
Blank you there.
Sorry about that, Bill, froze for a second. Rodney Blake Topmeyer with Knoxville News Sentinel. This is kind of a follow-up. You mentioned being an attack and react type front. I was wondering if you could elaborate kind of what you feel like the hallmarks would be of the defensive line in this scheme. How would you like to see your guys play?
Well, obviously, you know, you want to play violent. You know, it's a violent game. You know, we want to strike. We want to create knockback. We want to perfect, you know, block destruction. You know, be able to hold the point on the different combo blocks, and just be very disruptive up front. And also at the same time, being mindful of you know, that we've got to protect that second level guys too, and not just let guys climb. So when I say attack and react, we're not just going to be running upfield, but we've got to read our pressure points as we're working vertical. And we've got to recognize the different blocking schemes that we're getting, and we got to be able to play those blocks.
Rodney Matter, Sports Illustrated. Shortly after you were hired here at Tennessee, I asked Eric Brown what kind of coach Tennessee was getting in Rodney Garner. He told me they got the best damn coach in college football. He will not only grow those guys as players, but as men as well. My question to you is, how important is it for you to not only be able to relate and develop these guys on the field, but play a role off the field in developing them into a man?
Well, you know, obviously, you know, I look at this, you know, as my ministry. And this is what I want to pour into these young men. And the thing that we sell to these families, you know, they're going to give me a young man, and I want to give them a man back. So, you know, we have the holistic approach, you know, that obviously they all want to play at the next level. You ask them man for man, that's what you hear. But, you know, I want them to be good students. I want them to get a degree. I want them to be good men off the field. You know, my role is I want them to be good husbands, good fathers, you know, good citizens, you know, so we're looking at that. And hopefully, you know, we can develop them spiritually, socially, and then athletically. And I feel like if we can encompass those other areas, then they're going to be good football players, because hopefully we're targeting the guys that have the skill set and the talent to be able to play at a high level. So if we're doing our job as far as developing them in other areas, then they should be very coachable, and we should be able to achieve their athletic goals along the process.
Last question, Eric Kane, and then we'll get Coach Ekeler.
Hey, Rodney, Eric Kane with the Sports Animal here in Knoxville. Welcome back to Knoxville. My question for you is, this defensive line group, it's had quite a bit of turnover in terms of coaching. As instructors the last couple of seasons, how important is it for those guys to have stability in one coach and one voice to kind of get better and continue on with their journey?
Well, I think stability is important in anything, and that was one of the things that, you know, Coach Heupel talked about. You know, I look at, you know, when we were talking, you know, when he was formulating his staff, you know, he's looking for men that wanted to be here at Tennessee and not look at it as a springboard to the next job. And, you know, and obviously, like I told him, I feel like, you know, UT is a destination spot. It's definitely a spot that, you know, I'm excited to be back at. I'm excited to help it get back to the elite status that it deserves. My family's excited about it. You know, obviously my second oldest daughter was born here at Fort Sanders. So to us, you know, it's just a combination of everything, of life coming full circle. And I'm hoping that we will be able to form and play at a level that we will be able to create consistency. And the only way we're going to do that, though, you know, obviously we're in the bottom line business. You know, we've got to perform, and we've got to play at a high level. But that's going to be our goal every day. You know, I'm committed to giving 110, 120% to help these young men in all areas in their lives to develop as players and as men, and help UT get back to where it belongs.
Thank you, Coach.
Thank you, guys. Go Vols.
Special teams coordinator and outside linebackers coach Mike Ekeler. To ask a question to Coach Ekeler, please hit the raise your hand function and we'll call on you. And please state your name and affiliation. We'll start with David Pascal, then we'll go to Jimmy Himes.
Mike, I'm curious. Josh was saying earlier just SEC experience was really important. And I know you and Rodney and Willie all worked under Coach Rick at Georgia. I know Rodney and Willie were ahead of you, but why do you view SEC, why is SEC experience so important in this league?
Well, it's a whole different deal. I've coached in all Power 5 conferences, been in the SEC a total of 5 years, three at LSU and three at Georgia, or two at Georgia, excuse me. And to have that experience, it's just different. It's different than the Big 12. It's different than the ACC. And, you know, it's the deep end of the pool.
Jimmy Himes with Sports Animal in Knoxville. Could you kind of give us an idea of what you want your special teams units to look like?
One thing that that we'll do is we'll play our tails off, and we're gonna be all about technique, and we're gonna play hard, and we're gonna play clean.
What do you feel like you have with the skill position players you've inherited?
Just having watched every clip last year of our special teams, really feel like they really have a good foundation and a good culture from a special team standpoint. The guys played hard. I think we've got some good, really good skill players, and I'm excited to get out there in spring practice and work with them.
Ben McKee and Austin Price.
Coach Ben McKee, Rocky Top Insider. From the outside linebacker perspective, just what have been your initial thoughts of the guys you have inherited there, and what will kind of be your main focus those first couple of weeks of the spring practice?
Well, really have seen them on the field only one time, just having gotten here last week and watching them on film last year. Excited. I think we've got a lot of talent there, got some speed. Just excited to get out there in spring practice and work with them and see these guys develop.
Coach, in watching your Twitter activity over the weekend, you were recalling your first game coaching in the Neil in 2005. What was it about that game? And then take me through kind of maybe what you see as a difference in maybe Neyland Stadium versus some of the other big venues you coached and could you question quite a few?
Sure. Well, I just remember walking in there. First of all, you walk in that stadium and it's absolutely beautiful. I mean, it's incredible. It's all symmetrical and just it's probably one of the most breathtaking just structures you've been in. Then you toss in 103,000 people and they start singing Rocky Top and it just, it's an electric environment. I remember I was up in a press box at the time and and the things like shaking and swaying, and it was pretty awesome. So ever since that, I think we ended up coming out on top where I was in overtime, but it was an unbelievable battle, and just had a great experience.
Like Topmeyer than David Oven.
Yeah, Mike, like Topmeyer, the Spill News Sentinel. I was wondering, is it a true story or an urban legend that you and Jeremy Pruitt got into a fight when you guys were on staff together there in Georgia?
You know what? The only thing I'll say about my experience at Georgia is worked for Mark Richt, an unbelievable guy, and really had a great experience working for him. Incredible person. And, you know, I'm just excited about what we're doing here.
And I'll follow up in a different direction. You're someone who's worked on the defensive side of the ball at a lot of places, but now gotten into kind of this special teams thing. Why is that a direction you wanted to take your career, and what do you think it takes to make a good special teams coach?
Well, going back, when they added the 10th coach, that's really when I decided to go the special teams route. Because I'd always gone, you know, linebackers, defensive coordinator, and so forth. And I've always loved special teams, but at that point, a lot of head coaches hadn't put the emphasis on it. And I saw it as an opportunity. You know, that's kind of how I made my name as a player. And I love that aspect of it. You get a coach every single player on the team. And it's all – you get to teach them I call it transferable skill. So a kickoff, for example, it's no different. We'll pull a clip of a receiver stemming a corner, stepping on his toes, running a post cut. Guys, that's all you're doing. It's the same thing. We'll pull a clip of a linebacker setting up a block and look him in the eyes and sticking him and it's all about space. It's all about where's the ball, where's the block, how much space do I have, teaching them relationships. So to sum it up, it's you're teaching your entire team all the fundamentals of ball. So that's what I really enjoy, working with every player and getting out there. And the other thing that it's fun about it is you got one shot at this. You know, it's not like offense, not like defense where you have three opportunities. You got one shot. So your chili better be hot. You better be ready to rock and roll. And I enjoy that because I wake up about 3 a.m. every day and I don't need a cup of coffee. I'm ready to go.
David. Mike, do you anticipate, I guess, I don't know if having access is the right word, but using starters on your special teams unit, either for tournament or, you know, gunners, those kind of things?
In the past where I've been, we haven't used a lot of starters. And here's the reason. You have an opportunity to develop your whole entire roster, and you have an opportunity to leave some tread on the tires, so to speak, of your starters. But we're going to use exactly who we have to, or who we need to be the best in the conference. So I don't know what that looks like right now, and that's the fun part of spring ball. Our job as a special teams coordinator, my job is to identify every single player on our roster, identify their skill sets. And that's what we'll do, and we'll plug them in.
Trey Wallace and Eric King.
Trey Wallace, Rocky Top Insider. I spoke with one of your former players last week in Wilk Compton.
Oh, yeah.
And he started to get into the stories of your recruiting tactics and what you did in Nebraska when it comes to that last in-home visit of showing him a tattoo on your arm. I'm interested to hear what it's like for you to be on the road. What are you trying to preach kids? And if you can you finish that story on how your 24-mile run in Lincoln ended?
Oh, yeah. That was first of all, just in recruiting, it's about connecting with these kids. And as a coach, once you connect with them and once they understand and they get here, and former players like a Will Compton, I mean, I told Will when he stepped foot on campus, and I've told every player this, that, guys, it's my job as a coach to earn your respect. And so let me be clear about that. You know, if I can't make you the best linebacker in Will's case in the country, then I'm worthless to you. That's my job. And so then it's my job to earn your trust. And what that happens over time. It's not going to happen overnight. It's going to happen in the fourth quarter when, you know what, hits a fan and we're down against Auburn. And how? What am I going to do? Am I going to point a finger? Am I going to point a thumb? You know, are we in this together or are we really in it together? So that takes time. And then after you get those two components, the third thing, once you figure out I actually care about you, I love you, now we got something. So in recruiting process, it's really conveying that to the recruits and getting in front of them and really just getting to know them on a personal level, getting to know their families and know who they are and what they're about. And to finish the story on the run, we were practicing. It was spring practice. We had a Friday practice. It was not one of our best practices. My wife and kids were out of town. They're actually in St. Louis. And I told our guys, we had an early morning scrimmage in Memorial Stadium on Saturday. I said, hey, fellas, we're going to have the greatest practice in the history of Nebraska football today. I said, when we do, so I'm going to go run a marathon. And lo and behold, I mean, Levante, David, and Will Compton, and a bunch of other dudes out there just wrecking shop. We had an unbelievable practice. So after practice, we go, and we had a bunch of boosters there. So we had a big barbecue. And so we're under the stadium eating barbecue. And then one of my good friends, Joe Moglia, who was with us, he's the CEO of TD Ameritrade, went on to become the head coach at Coastal Carolina. He lived in Omaha. And so you take I-80 from Lincoln to Omaha, and I said, hey, Joe, will you drop me off? And so he dropped me off 27 and a half miles away from the stadium on I-80. It was 90 degrees out. I will admit, though, there was a wind at my back. And so I took off, started running. All I had was a little headset, and I had my GPS, you know, that tracked how your splits and so forth. So I got to running, and I think I was 23 and a half miles in, and I hear these sirens come up behind me. And it scared the heck out of me now because I'm just running on the shoulder of the interstate. And I look behind me, and it's a police officer pulling me over. And he goes, son, what are you doing? And I said, officer, I'm running a marathon. He goes, you can't run out of here. I said, what do you mean? He goes, it's illegal. And so he made me get in a police car, and I'm sitting in there. I didn't have a shirt on. I was sweating like Moses Malone in the fourth quarter. And so I get in there and I look in the mirror, and it looked like I had rabies because it was 90 degrees out. I'd been running 22 and a half miles. I had cotton mouth like you couldn't believe. And so he said, give me your name. And I said, Mike Ekeler. And he goes, Coach Eck? He goes, what are you doing, man? And I told him, and he goes, I said, officer, how far am I for the 56th Street exit? He said, you're 2 miles away. I said, that's where I'm turning. That's where I'm going to the stadium. I said, just let me finish. He said, I can't do that. I can get fired if you get hurt. So I said, well, I am kind of tired. How about if you just give me a ride back to the stadium then? So that's how it ended. So I never finished it.
Thank you. Last question, Brent.
Yeah, Coach, they're kind of following up a little bit on that. Where does your intensity come from? I mean, obviously you're known for your intensity. Where does that stem from? What's kind of brought that out of you as a young age, and why have you been able to consistently carry that through your career, regardless of where you're at or what you're doing?
I think it's just DNA. You know, I think it's how you're wired as a person. It's no different than everybody's got a different coaching style, right? Everybody's got a different personality, and I just happen to enjoy Red Bull, and that's kind of how I coach.
All right, thank you, Coach.
Appreciate y'all.
start back up with linebackers coach Brian Jean-Marie to ask a question to coach. Please hit the raise your hand function. We'll go to Eric Kane, then Patrick Brown.
Eric Kane, the Sports Animal, and welcome to the Knoxville, coach. Been a lot of turnover at that inside linebacker spot with guys leaving to the portal and going here and there and graduating and whatnot. What have you seen from those guys so far in your time in Knoxville, and how do you think they've responded to hearing off-season conditioning and all that?
First off, thank you for having me here. They've been great. The guys have been attentive and very eager to learn, Coach Banks' new system. They've, come in with a bounce in their step, with some of the things that Coach Heupel has, installed so far for the program. So it's been great every day that we've got a chance to get together. Those guys, like I said, they've been sponges, kind of getting to the point where they're a lot more comfortable asking questions. And, obviously they wanted to get a chance to know me as an individual coach and learn, Coach Banks' system as far as defense. But everything has been positive so far. I have no complaints.
Hey, Ryan, Patrick Brown with 24/7 Sports. You spent, I think, a decade with Charlie Strong at a couple different places in the Rural Michigan last year. What made this the time to jump to Tennessee and come work with the staff? And what do you remember about your games against UCF when you were down there at USF as a defensive coordinator?
First off, obviously, Coach Strong was a big mentor for me. He was gave me my first opportunity along with Coach Holtz to actually work in this conference. So I was a graduate assistant with those guys back in the early 2000s. But I felt like the time was right. Obviously, I have a history with Coach Heupel, respect, everything that he's done as far as not just the offensive, guy, but, as a coordinator, but also what he did as a head coach, down at Central Florida. I think he's got, the right mix of, explosive offense, but they also, did a great job as a full team to win, here in this conference. So it was enticing and it was, offer, too good to turn down. And just, from, like I said, from the experiences at UCF, like I said, a very, very explosive, an aggressive team, they're a team that, going to take their shots, obviously, as far as getting downfield, but a team that you had to defend from sideline to sideline, that was going to be equally as explosive, with the pass game as they were with the run game, and probably one of the more difficult teams to prepare for, that I've had, to prepare for throughout my whole career. So to be on, obviously a team with him, like I said, was too enticing. And I know they're going to put some points on the board and give us a chance to win a lot of games.
David Oven, then Gustavo.
Hey, Brian. David Oven with The Athletic. How would you describe the role and responsibilities of middle linebackers in this defense?
With any defense, I know it. There's different defenses and different fronts and different responsibilities with every defense you have. But the middle linebacker is always going to be the captain of the defense. That's kind of through history has proven. So that guy's going to have to be the captain. He's going to have to be the guy that communicates with the front, four guys, the defensive line, outside linebackers, and communicate with the secondary. So there is a leadership role that comes with that position, and he's going to be the captain of the defense, whether it's obviously not necessarily the captain of the team, but he's got to take the leadership role and be one of the guys that, obviously the rest of the guys on defense look to kind of right the ship, on the field without the coaches being there with him.
Coach Gustavo Tomaselli, WHK 90.3, The Rock. You worked in some big schools on the Big Ten, Big 12, and the ACC, but the first time you worked in an SEC school, how you feel about that, you take on a school in the SEC, which is a so tough conference?
It's a great challenge. You know, obviously the SEC is regarded as the best football conference in college football. So, you know, you have an opportunity to come here, especially at a program, you know, like the University of Tennessee. It's a great challenge and one that, you know, you're always looking forward to, you know, see, you know, how you will do as a coach in this conference. And you're playing against the, you know, playing and coaching against, you know, the best players and the best coaches in college football. So it's exciting. It's exciting. You know, you get a chance to, you know, obviously match wits, but obviously, you know, go against some of the, you know, better programs in the country. So, you know, if you feel like you're, you know, a good coach and you're tied to a, you know, obviously a good program, it's something that, like I said, it's an opportunity, you know, once in a lifetime opportunity, I would say, that, you know, you wouldn't turn down and you're excited to be a part of.
Go to Ben McKee and Austin Price.
Coach Ben McKee of Rocky Top Insider. Have you had a chance to reach out to Henry Toto'o and Kavarsh Crouch? And also, just with those two kind of being in the transfer portal and maybe undecided, has it been difficult to get a grasp of your new room with those two guys undecided?
No, first part of the question, I've had conversations with them, but with them being in the portal, you know, my focus has been the guys that are here. And, you know, the room with the guys that are here has been fine. I mean, that's just part of football, and you guys all know that from covering football. No matter how well or, you know, how thoughtfully planned out something is, you know, between injuries and other circumstances, you have to go with the guys that are available, and that's kind of how we're looking at it. You know, obviously those two are great players, you know, and we'll see what happens with them, you know, obviously in the future. But for right now, I'm focusing on the guys that are with us, and like I said, they've been great and, you know, like I said, have been sponges soaking up everything that we're doing and been very, very happy with, you know, the guys that are here, you know, going through the weightlifting and the conditioning every day, you know, as part of the volunteer program.
Coach Austin Price, MarQuest and Rivals, how important, you know, like spring practice is when you're a new defensive staff? A lot of the experience on the staff may be on the defensive side, but the continuity lies on offense. So for you guys to get continuity working together in the meeting room, on the practice field, and then two, specifically at your position, you talk about everything, you know, you like what you see, or to this point, or they're doing everything you're asking them to do. Do you think it feels like, because there has been change at your position and change with the staff, that, you know, with the newness, kind of, you're starting fresh together instead of old ideas versus new ideas?
I think so. The first part of your question, spring practice is, you know, is one of the most important parts as far as building a team. As you saw last year, without, you know, a lot of teams getting spring practice because, you know, of the COVID-19 epidemic, you saw how slow some teams started, and probably, you know, guys were having to figure each other out, you know, coaches and players, because they didn't have the spring practice. So I think it's very, very important. And, you know, as far as the staff and the players, it is our first introduction to, you know, football. You know, 11-on-11 with us putting a, you know, a actual game plan in and watching these guys run around, and it's the closest thing we're going to get to a game. So, yeah, it's going to be very, very important. And like I said, it's a process, because they're getting to know us and we're getting to know them. We know their strengths and weaknesses. You know, we'll know them a lot better once we get out of spring practice. But I think with the, you know, some of the veteran guys that we have on staff here, they've been in a lot of different systems and have, you know, had the opportunity to, you know, obviously coach under a bunch of different coaches. So I think it's been a seamless transition with those guys. We, you know, Coach Banks has done a great job of bringing in, you know, his package and, you know, allowing guys to kind of, you know, fit what, how they see things into that package. And it's been, you know, it's been good. And obviously we want to see how that works, you know, going into spring practice, but everything has been great so far.
Coach Jimmy Himes with the Sports Animal in Knoxville. With the offenses that you see, the variety of offenses and the up-tempo, how important is it for you to have three down linebackers?
Obviously, it's going to be important because, I, you know, with the up-tempo offenses, they keep the guys that are on the field, during the first and second down. They keep them on the field on third down if they're going at a certain tempo where you can't sub to get your different packages in. So we have to have guys that are versatile enough, obviously, to be good enough to stop the run and, are going to be, obviously adequate enough to defend the pass. That's kind of the problems with going against up-tempo offenses, because they can get you in a certain package and keep you in it, if you're not able to stop them, on third down. So that's going to be, one of our main goals coming out of spring, is to see which linebackers we have that can stay on the field, no matter the situation.
Thank you, Coach. We'll move on now to Coach Martinez.
You guys have a good one.
Today with secondary coach Willie Martinez. To ask a question to Coach Martinez, please hit the raise your hand function and please state your name and affiliation. We'll start with Eric Kane and then we'll go to David Pastor.
Eric Kane, Esports Animal here in Knoxville. Coach, I believe you had the opportunity to coach Tim Banks at Central Michigan. How was that experience and how unique is it to work with him here in Tennessee?
Obviously, Tim was a senior when I went to Central Michigan. It was only the 1 year that I was there in 1994. So I was blessed in a sense where I got a chance to really coach a kind of a veteran group. And Tim was one of the captains, so to speak, one of the leaders on the defense, not and on the team. But he was a fierce competitor, smart, tough. Obviously had a tremendous amount of playmaking ability. And it's the same year too that we won the MAC championship, and it was a special time. I had just left Grand Valley State with obviously somebody you guys know very well, Brian Kelly, and then my opportunity to get back in the Division I and to win a championship right off the bat, and first time there, being there, tradition there at the school, and to be a part of a team that, again, had really good senior leadership led by Tim Banks. And Tim was a great player, like I said. And to be around him now, obviously, we've been friends for a long time. And the great thing about the business, the job that we have is exactly what we say in recruiting, making an impact in their lives and helping them develop to be the men they want to be and reach their goals and dreams and aspirations. And to sit there and now be beside him and him leading the defense is obviously it's special for me, because that's one of the players I had the obviously the blessing of being able to coach. So it's kind of a cool deal.
Willie, hey, David Pascal here in Chattanooga. Hope you've been doing well. Wanted to ask, you walked into the SEC 20 years ago, and I'm just curious, what has evolved and changed the most for you coaching defensive backs? What's different about it now compared to when you were 20 years ago?
It's going to be a very popular answer, The offenses were, you know, you the speed of the game has changed. You know, the tempo of the game has changed. That's the first thing that comes to mind. Obviously, in this league, there's a tremendous amount of, you know, great athletic players at each position, probably the best in the country. And so the talent is obviously it's great, but it's the speed, it's the tempo of the offenses, you know, being able to try and defend the entire field sideline to sideline. You know, you got to play with the same personnel on the field. Used to be able to change that personnel grouping because you had time. The strategies have changed, obviously the rules have changed, but I would say the offenses.
David Ubben and Brent Hubbs.
Lou, what do you make of the defensive backs that you're inheriting?
Well, I'm actually pretty big. I've been excited. I mean, there's some guys in the room that obviously I was a part of recruiting. That's kind of neat to see and watch them through the years here and develop to be the people they've become and the players they are. But I think it's a locked-in group. I think it's somebody, a group that really, really wants to get better each and every day. I mean, it's really been an awesome experience for me and Coach Banks, obviously, in the back end. So got some leadership guys that know how to lead, guys that have the respect of their teammates. And you kind of need that in the back end, especially at the last line of defense.
And also this offense, what does it do to secondaries that allows it to have so much success throwing the ball down the field?
I'm going to take a positive to that answer, to that question. Okay. And a lot of guys will, and that's really myself evolving as a coach, especially in the secondary. The tempo of the offense is now. And the great thing about it is we get a chance to practice it. I've been a part of it now for a couple of years when I was at Oklahoma, and then obviously defending it. But also on a daily basis, though, this will be the sixth year in an offense that goes basically at warp speed. So you kind of like have to be ready to go. You just can't. You're not just going to line up and practice and kind of ease your way through. Not that anybody does that, but I mean, it starts right from the beginning. The tempo is fast. It's fast in thinking, obviously, along with the running part of it, but to process stuff very quickly. So to practice that every day, each period, it's only going to be a positive for the defense. It's almost like you'll get to the game, and I know being a part of it is that sometimes you get these offenses that are no huddle, and they don't quite go as fast as our offense is going to be going. And so they kind of like slows the game down a little bit for them. So still being some games where, come on, man, hurry up and snap the ball, which gives them the time that they've been able to practice that process each and every day. Then when it comes to game times, it's a little bit slower for them. They can process a little bit quicker. And so that's the positive of being involved in defending this each and every day, and the mindset and kind of knowing the ins and outs and how you go about doing that. So, you know, you focus on the things that you have to do to be successful as a defensive back. What is that? Well, once that play's over with, get yourself lined up, get yourself in a play routine, like we like to say. Identify the down and distance, identify the personnel call, identify the call that's being given to you, and then get your eyes in the right spot to define what they lined up in and where are the go-to guys. You know, and that you got to do that all in about 6 to 7 seconds. And to be able to practice that every day, you know, it'll be where they're going to be ready for it. It's not going to be something that's going to really bother them. So you got to pay attention to details. That's going to be important. You have to embrace the process. You know, don't look at it like a grind every day. Anything that you do, how you do anything is how you do everything. That's kind of like what we say. And if you are prepared, and your detail in academics, in whoever you're meeting with, whether it's the strength coach, you know, being early, being on time, have a plan already processed through prior to coming into that room or into that meeting, and it's only going to help you have success on the field.
Coach Martinez, Brent Hubbs with VolQuest.com. Welcome back to Knoxville. Two things. One, you're the one who's been here most recently. How much does that help in terms of talking to the defensive staff about
kind of the Tennessee experience and recruiting to Tennessee and expectations at Tennessee and all of that. And then two, kind of follow up to what you just talked about, how do you avoid not being too simplistic in the back end when you're having to go warp speed, that you can still be complex enough to affect an offense, but you're playing at such a fast pace? How do you balance that?
To the first question, you know, I told the guys, you know, and obviously they'll ask me the questions, you know, what about Tennessee? And this is a tremendous place. This is a special place. I mean, the first day that I came here back in 2013 is the same excitement that I had when I came back. I mean, it's a place that has so much tradition, so much success, a passionate fan base that wants nothing but success. They follow you. They're passionate. It's important to them. I mean, it's like, when I was recruiting here the last time I was here, and even when I'm with another school, you know, you walk around and you wear that power T. You walk in, it doesn't matter what state in this country, and let alone across, you know, sometimes you got to go out of the states. You know exactly what school it is. You know, that it's an unbelievable tradition, and so it's never been a recruit that I've been a part of when we brought them here from wherever they came from that they didn't really enjoy themselves in Rocky Top, you know. So that's what I remember, and that's kind of like how I feel now. And there's so many great players that have played here, and it's not just football, man. We're talking about all sports, and so there's so much to pull from to sit there and say, well, look, this one here went here, and she went here, and look at the success they had, and there's tremendous tradition here. To your second question, I'm sorry, can you repeat that, Brent? What was it?
Yeah, just
being about simple.
Simple, but you have to go fast versus being complex.
Well, it's funny you say that, but from a fundamental standpoint, from a thought process, like I had said a little bit earlier, about just embrace the process. Well, it starts with the beginning, you know what I mean, of a play. You know what I mean? Don't look at anything else other than you can handle looking over to the sideline and get a down distance situation. Then you can actually look at our personnel calls or what they have in the game. That's something that doesn't need anything but just looking. Now, once you do that, being able to process what they have shown formation wise, okay, you've practiced it. You're going against an offense that's going really fast. It's a positive. Sometimes it looks like it's unreal, but guys, listen to me. Trust us that in the process, if you embrace it, okay, it may look a little bit, you know, not realistic how fast they're going in practice, because sometimes it goes faster than normal. But if you're able to process it and focus on your job, okay, you do simple better from your standpoint. What's your job? What is your job? Define it, you know, and then what's the call that we give you? You know what I mean? Within that, you got to have some kind of an idea as we put in the defensive calls. You got to know the weaknesses and strengths of that defense comparable to what they might do. Okay. So they're going to do exactly what you show them what we're going to do, but then we'll have the ability to change that. Okay. You have to be able to do that. Okay. But it won't be something that we haven't practiced. You know what I mean? That's what the offenses do. They look over the sideline and see, you know, look for a different check, how the defense looks. You got to be able to do that same thing on defense. And so it becomes a chess match. So I don't think it's that we're going to be simple. That's not going to be the case. We're going to have a strategy, a scheme that will counter anything that the offense is doing. Okay. What we got to do is just play relentless, be locked in and focused and play relentless, because that's still going to be, it's not going to be so much the scheme as it's going to be how we play. Okay. It's going to be how the tempo that we play, you know, almost kind of like reverse the mindset. We're going to set the tempo. I know that they have the snap count and all that stuff, but by the way and the style that we can play, where we're relentless. Okay. There's no perfect call. It's really the ability to how you play as a unit. All 11 guys being on the same page, okay? Understanding what is our weakest link in that 11 guys. There's going to be weaknesses and how to play off of that and counter that, knowing that the offense knows that. And then that comes where coaching comes in, where you kind of give enough change-ups that plays to your strengths. And again, it's just a chess match. And most of the time that you face these fast tempo offenses, or how you have to defend all these offenses across America, a lot of it's because guys aren't locked in, okay, play after play after play. You know what I mean? They get out of their mindset of really what's important, and that's to play as a unit, play as one, okay? If you're going to play, if you're going to make a mistake, you're going to do it 100%. You're going to go fast, relentless, physical, okay? And if something does happen wrong, it's going to happen. Get back up, get back to your spot, wherever that is, whether you're a right-left corner, you know, a right-left defensive end, and then get the call and get ready and strap it up, and let's snap it up and we'll play the next play. It's the next play. Once that one's done, get on to the next play. It's a mindset.
Close with Patrick Brown.
Hey, Willie, Patrick Brown with 24/7 Sports. I'm kind of a two-part question. First of all, what was the process like to you getting coming back here when Coach Heupel took the Tennessee job? Did you think there was a chance you might come back to Knoxville? And secondly, you mentioned seeing some guys here that you recruited. Who were some of those guys? Maybe what was that interaction like when you saw them for the first time in a couple of years?
You know, I mean, obviously the. When Coach Heupel took the job, I mean, we really didn't know really what was going to happen. You know, obviously it was a process to it, and obviously I was at a great place, you know, where we won a lot of games and got a tradition of their own going right now. Obviously I'm from Florida, you know, so I had the best of two worlds there, you know what I mean? I had an opportunity to come back to a special place like Tennessee and work for Coach Heupel, who I think is a great leader. And then I got a chance to maybe possibly stay. You know, I didn't really know, but I'm excited to be here. Looking forward to my round two, so to speak, here at Rocky Top. So I'm fired up about that. And then, you know, coming back to, you know, you a couple guys that I was a part of recruiting. Theo Jackson is somebody, obviously, that, you know, is somebody that I wanted when I was here. We wanted, basically, and thought he was the right mindset. We thought he was the right athlete, and that's kind of like holds true to form right now, and just watching the video that I've watched on him and the person that he's become, and Alante Taylor's another one that actually committed to us at a young age that I had recruited, I mean, as a young man. I mean, we're talking about 9th, 10th grade year, and to see how he's become and the leader that he's become is really exciting. That's why you know, for me, that's why I got into coaching. You know, it was first, I've had a lot of great mentors, a lot of coaches that throughout my life, especially at a young age, you know, but they kind of have the same common theme, you know what I mean? To get into coaching, you know, it's really to have an impact in people's lives, to be able to share what you know and what you've gone through and then pay it forward, so to speak. And to see it, you know, to see Alante, you know, and to see Theo, that's what's so great about what I do, you know, to be a part of that, you know, in the coaching profession, is to see their development and to see the families that they come from and how proud they must be of them. And that's not to take away from anybody else that I haven't recruited there. You know, I know there's some there like Cheyenne. You know, Cheyenne has not had the career, obviously, from the injuries, but he's still a super, super young man. I mean, he's, you know, obviously we want nothing but the best for him moving forward. You know, and there's like other couple of guys there, like, you know, I told Danico, you know, Slaughter, you know, I tried to get him at the old school that I just came from, and you kind of dodged me, and all of a sudden, the last second, Rocky Top gets him, you know what I mean? I says, it's funny how things kind of come around. It's just like, you know, when I wanted Brian Randolph at another school that I was at, and all of a sudden, I come back, and I get a chance to coach him. Somehow, it just seems like, you know what I mean, if you try and do the best you can and do it the right way, and you recruit the right people, you know, it's the right fit. It's somehow you come back, get a chance to coach those type of, you know, student athletes that I once wanted to recruit, you know, and wanted for myself. So it's kind of cool to see them develop and to become the people they are right now.
Thank you, Coach. That concludes today's press conference.
Thank you, guys.